Well, 2019 has been a bit of a roller coaster ride for Toronto residents. Worry as the province takes an austere approach to spending. Fear as the city continues to grapple with a growing gun violence problem. And pure joy as our Raptors brought the NBA championship home to the Six. And leading us all the way through it was Mayor John Tory, who joins me live now for our annual year end update here. Thanks for joining us this morning.
Pleasure.
First off, you know, we're live at Yorkdale trying to get some donations for the Daily Bread Food Bank. We think about those people who are struggling to just put food on the table, keep roofs over their heads. And we start with affordable housing here. And I know that's been a huge topic this week in particular. Yesterday with the Canada Housing Benefit that was announced. And just want to get your feedback on that, because it sounds like it will be a supplement for some of the sky-high rent that we see here in Toronto. When do you think that will take place, and when can Toronto residents really start to apply for this?
Well, the spring. I mean, they're going to be able to get this in the spring. And here's the great thing about a housing benefit like that, is that it's going to put cash into people's hands, and that you can do reasonably quickly compared to the other parts of the housing plan that we just passed at City Council, which involve building new buildings. That obviously takes 2 years, 3 years. The first projects under the housing plan will be completed in 2022, but it doesn't help you if you're today having an affordability crisis in your life where you just can't find an apartment at all. The housing benefit going to certain groups, thousands of people in Toronto as a result of this announcement, and I thank the federal and provincial governments for doing it, will actually put money into people's hands to allow them to perhaps take on an apartment they might otherwise not have been able to take on. So it effectively subsidizes your rent, and I think that's another way, one of the many ways in which we're going to try to make the city more affordable, but those will be available starting in the spring.
Right, and for the housing TO plan that you just mentioned, this 10-year plan, plan of action for Toronto when it comes to affordable housing. First off, it's costing $23 billion, and I know that you were saying earlier this week that you still have to get other levels of government on board. Where do you stand right now trying to get that funding?
Well, yes, actually, the announcement this past week was a good beginning. It is part of the money, because we've said over the period of the 10 years, we're going to help 31,000 people with a rent supplement, a rent allowance, like the program announced yesterday. So several thousand people will be part of that 31,000. What we now need them to do, and there are some arrangements they have set aside for money already, to, for example, build supportive housing and staff it. I mean, supportive housing for people with, say, mental illness is not so much about the bricks and mortar, but it's about the staff that actually counsel or otherwise provide support for people so that they can live on their own and not be in a shelter or not be on the street. So that I'm going to have to advocate to them, and I took the opportunity yesterday at the announcement of the housing allowance to say, I don't want to seem like I'm lacking in gratitude for what you're doing today, but there is much, much more to be done. This is the fastest growing city in North America. It's the biggest city by far in Canada. And so I think there has to be an increasing recognition by both provincial and federal governments that that is going to give us challenges that are bigger than what you might face elsewhere. And so they do need to step up, and I'm talking to them about that, and they're not unreceptive, but just like we had to do with Toronto Community Housing Repairs and transit money, you've got to keep working together with them, keep at them, keep after them, and I think in the end we will get some successful results. But there's a lot of money that needs to be put up to achieve these goals.
Right, and some of that money coming from a new property levy that was
our
announced.
Share.
Yes, yeah. Our share for Toronto that was announced and passed at City Council earlier this week. Some people calling, even though it's a levy, calling it really a tax increase and saying that you're going against what you campaigned on, which was no property tax increases. What do you say to that?
Well, first of all, the campaign commitment that I made was that a property tax increase at the rate of inflation or below, not no tax increase. But I was fairly clear. But again, I don't want to quibble about it, because in the end, you know, money coming out of people's pockets, they can call it what they want. I mean, if people want to say it's a tax increase, it is an increase in the taxes people are paying. What we've tried to do is to separate very clearly as between a tax increase that is applied to finance the operating budget, police, fire, parks, roads, and all the things we do every day, and one that is clearly going to go only to these long-term big projects, transit and housing in particular. And I think people understand. I think they know the city's on the right track, but I think they know we have to build transit, we have to build more of this affordable housing, and I think they know it's not free. And so I think that they would trust me and the council, but trust me to show the leadership to say, all right, how are we going to pay for it? And there are very limited options. We tried road tolls. The provincial government said no. They then said they would replace the road tolls with some gasoline tax money, the government of the day canceled that. So we had to move because, to me, the option of just saying, well, sorry, we can't afford to build the affordable housing, we can't afford to build the transit, we don't have any money, was not on the table. And I have to be in a position, I think, when I go to these other governments, further to your earlier question, and say, I need your help, where I can say, we've put up our share. Torontonians have paid their share. And so that's what we did, and people will judge that, you know, at the time of the next election, if not before. But I'm confident that it's the right thing to do to protect our success, to keep Toronto going in the right direction, that it just isn't an option not to build the transit and not to provide for affordable housing.
Okay. Staying on the property tax vein here, the highest and best use taxes. We've been speaking to a lot of business owners, small businesses, especially on Yonge Street and other parts of downtown that are now waiting for their 2020 property assessment, many of them dreading it because they've seen their property taxes jump 500% in some cases for very few of those businesses. And I know that the city has done what they can, what it can to limit that amount. Is there anything more long-term that you're looking at, the city's looking at,
well,
to help those small businesses?
What we have done is, I'll call it a Band-Aid, but that's what it is. It's all we can do is we've capped the actual property tax increase any of those small businesses can face at 10%. Mm-hmm. But the real problem is what you said right at the beginning. Every piece of property seems to be assessed these days on the basis that it will be a condo tower. And of course, that would make the assessment very high. The fact is, not every piece of property is going to be a condo tower. In fact, we must make sure that's not the case. And we must make sure there's still a place for smaller businesses and smaller landlords to continue to exist. So the province has to change the assessment system so that every piece of property is not potentially assessed as a condo site, and create a class of assessment that would say this is going to be a site that is going to be different. It is going to be a lower rise, smaller business, whatever kind of piece of property. And I've written to them formally so that it's in writing that we want them to do that. They haven't said no, but like a lot of things in government, if I have a New Year's resolution, is to try and speed up the process with which everything works, because these letters go into kind of a black hole. Yep. They don't say no. If they said no, I'd feel happier because I'd know, okay, that option's not on the table. But it is on the table. I think they support, the province does, small business. So that is a real problem. And you cannot have a city, as much as we're very happy about the booming growth that's going on here and the confidence that represents, that is entirely consistent of condo towers and office towers. So we have put our oar in on that and just said we need to do this both to protect business and to accept the reality that the city cannot be entirely high-rise buildings.
You talk about the city growing and, of course, the traffic out there, people taking transit and having to pay a little bit more likely come March of 2020. We've already seen a TTC fare hike this past April of 10 cents for most of the fares, as well as $5 in April and another $5 again, which will come up in March 20th. So people over the last less than a year, really, paying a lot more than they were for the TTC. But we know that this money is being raised, of course, in some cases, just to maintain what we have. What do you say to people who say, I can't deal with anymore, and having to deal with that plus the fare evasion?
Well, so we've tried to deal with that in terms of the affordability of it, especially for people with the lowest of incomes, in that we have, for the first time in the city's history ever, in the last 2 years, phased in the introduction of a low-income fare pass, so that first starting with people on social assistance, and then last year people who are getting child care subsidies, and now this year we begin the task of introducing it for lower-income people generally. So it's meant to say, well, we understand for some people it's a real struggle. Secondly, we're using the money to improve service so that there's 5 bus routes, for example, that carry 160,000 people a day in total. We're going to be augmenting that service. The money's going to be used to hire 120 new bus drivers, because for every service improvement you make, you have to have people to drive the buses. So we're doing all kinds of things like that to try and make the service more reliable and better. But I understand the fact it's not easy. We've also introduced, over the time I've been mayor, kids ride free 12 and under. We've introduced the hop-on, hop-off transfer, for example, when you can get on and off the system in a 2-hour period, which you couldn't do before. This amounts to something that saves a lot of people a lot of money. So while I'm not diminishing the fact that the fare has gone up 10 cents, at the same time, we've also said, well, in that 2-hour window, you can get on and off, whereas before you used to have to pay 2 or 3 times if you went to pick up the kids and then do an errand and go to the library. Mm-hmm. So there are things we're trying to do to make it more affordable, but the fact is, much of the cost here is going to the drivers and the people who keep the system system safe and operating properly. Much of it goes to pay for a pay increase. That's inflation, but it, you know, that amounts to a lot of money. Mm-hmm. And so I would just say we're going to make every effort to make sure, certainly for the people that are struggling the most, that we make available some help for them. But we have to keep improving the service, and that costs money. And the real answer in the end is what used to happen 15, 20 years ago. The province of Ontario used to make a significant contribution to the operation of the TTC. They stopped doing that about 15 years ago. They should start again. This is the economic engine of the country. 15% almost of the rides on the TTC are taken by people who live in 905 and contribute nothing to the operating cost of the TTC through their taxes. They pay their fare, but they don't contribute, and I think that's wrong. You know, the people in Toronto are subsidizing their rides every single day, and we're nice people here, but I mean, that isn't fair.
What about the Ontario line now? Of course, this is the crown jewel in the province's transit plan. Is there any concern, especially with news earlier this week, that the province canceled the Hamilton LRT? I know it was promised by the previous Liberal government, but is there concern about the Ontario line actually coming to fruition?
Well, here's the difference. The Ontario line was conceived of by the current government, by Premier Ford and his colleagues. The agreement that we entered into to build it was an agreement we entered into with that government. And we did it like 3 months ago. So to me, I mean, the notion that this one will end up falling victim to some problem with costs or so on is, I think, zero, just because they conceived of it, they are paying for it, they signed an agreement with us to build it, and it was all done very recently. So I'm optimistic, as much as it did bog us down a little bit from the plans we had earlier to build the relief line and the Scarborough subway and so on, that it's a plan they conceived of. I happily signed the agreement because I think it's good for Toronto, and we'll get on with it now. That's the challenge for us, is them and us get on with building it, because we need it. We need it in places like Thorncliffe Park and Flemington Park. We need it all the way down to provide relief for the Yonge Street subway, which is overcrowded, so we're going to get on with it.
Okay, and speaking of, talking to the province and signing those deals, we know that with Queen's Park there was a bit of a tense relationship in the beginning. Since the federal election, it seems that the government has been trying to strike a new tone of sorts. Has your relationship with the Premier, have you seen any changes at all?
Well, yes, I have. I mean, because in the first period of his time in office, and it may well be just something where he was settling in, but we were getting all these, you know, I've described them as emails at midnight saying a policy's changed, we're cutting something, we're canceling something, there was no consultation, no discussion, no nothing. And this is with the biggest city in the country and something that admittedly everybody says is the economic engine of Ontario. Now it is much, much better. I mean, the ministers are coming and consulting in advance. The Premier himself is in touch with me about these different things. We talk about things in advance. That doesn't mean, look, if the occasion arises where I have to fight again, I will fight, because my job is to fight for Toronto and make sure that it gets what it needs and that things are not cut unilaterally. But I would say there's been a big improvement in the degree to which they communicate, that they realize we're partners in getting things done together on things like childcare. I mean, I was talking to the Premier recently about childcare and just saying, look, it's fine to sort of, on some, you know, our accountant's desk, cross out a line that has to do with childcare. It's not so fine, you know, for the families where somebody's going to have to stop working, and that might in turn lead to them losing their house because they can't keep making the mortgage payments. And so, you know, we'll talk, but at least we're talking about these issues now as opposed to reacting to some cut that comes in an email. So we'll keep doing that. That's my job, is to both work together but also to stand up for Toronto, and I won't hesitate in 2020 or any other time to do that.
One thing you'll need the province's, agreement with is your handgun ban. It's something that you have been very firm on wanting it for the city. But in order for Toronto to take action, you will need the province to agree in some way. Do you have any confidence that that may happen?
Well, current indications would suggest that'll be a difficult challenge. Now, the federal law allowing us to do anything has not yet been introduced by the newly elected government. But I would just say this to you. We need to do some things. The status quo is not satisfactory in terms of the shootings that are going on and so on. The number of homicides is actually down this year quite a bit, but the number of shootings is up. And so I'll be canvassing. I'm going to call together a meeting of the mayors from the GTA, and we will invite somebody from the province and the federal government to come and sit down and say, all right, we're trying to provide additional support for the police through the police budget. We're advocating changes to laws like the bail laws, which are producing some ridiculous results of people being out two and three times on gun charges. And we're going to be allocating increased investment to kids and families to help address the root causes of crime. But if people have other ideas, if they think we can work together better as governments to address what I think is a serious problem, then we will. And the gun thing, there's no question the supply of guns, however you try and attack it, is a big problem. There are too many guns on our street. I've asked the question many times, why does anybody who lives in the city of Toronto need a handgun? And I never really get a satisfactory answer to that. So we'll have to work at that, but it does require all the governments to cooperate to cut the supply of guns, which is, I think, almost job one in terms of cutting down on these shootings.
All right. I want to quickly get to Vision Zero.
Yep.
I know that, of course, you're aiming to bring that number down to zero of fatal collisions out on our streets. Unfortunately, right now, we're up to 60 at least when it comes to fatal collisions in Toronto. Do you think something needs to be changed with Vision Zero? I know that photo radar has been brought back to certain areas, but what else needs to be done?
Well, I think we're doing a whole host of things. You mentioned photo radar is something just in the last week we began to implement. We've doubled the number of red light cameras. We've made hundreds of speed limit changes. We're changing the configuration of roads across the city to, cause people to be more careful. But I think the fundamental thing, Tammy, hasn't changed that we have to do, which is to get people to change their own behavior. Photo radar will help, but we've got to get people to change their behavior. People are driving too fast. They're not looking out for the other person. And that is something that only people can do. But I think the program has the necessary elements now that if we can combine all this better enforcement with people changing their behavior, and we've made big progress on the serious injuries this year, it's just the fatalities have been unacceptably high. I mean, any number above zero is unacceptably high, but they've been unacceptably high. And I just think we're going to have to really keep at it in 2020. But we've really got to count on people to slow down, stop the distracted driving. And the onus does rest principally on car drivers. Mm-hmm. That's the way it is. I mean, people are in these big, powerful vehicles, and everybody else, pedestrians and cyclists, are more vulnerable.
All right. Last thing we want to get to here is the Raptors win. Some happy news over there.
I was going to say, we're getting to, that was the, obviously the highlight of the year. You know why? Not just because we won a championship, that was great.
Okay.
But when you saw how much it brought people together in the city, and I was in Jurassic Park almost every game, and the people who were there were people, some of them weren't even basketball fans. They were just people having a good time, loving life in Toronto.
Right.
And, I thought it was fantastic.
You definitely thought it was fantastic. And we'll listen to just a little clip here.
This is the best team. These are the best fans. This is the greatest city. Oh, my God, it's incredible. What a finish.
To be repeated.
To be repeated, right?
Right.
We'll do it?
Exactly.
Okay.
And then the Leafs.
All right. Okay.
That'll be even bigger if possible.
We'll see.
Okay.
All right.
You.
Thank you again, Mayor Tory, for joining us for this year-end interview. We're going to send things over to Dee now at Yorkdale. Dee.